now is Nasik Maharaj. He was the class. So Maharaj will start the class now. And we will continue until 8:30 for Sayana until the 4 o'clock. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Nana Shastra Vichari Naikanipano Sadhamma Samsapako
Nana Shastra Vichari Naikanipano Sadhamma Samsapako
Nana Shastra Vichari describing pure devotional service. There are different levels of devotional service, you see. There is mixed devotion and there is pure devotion. So this book is highlighting the meaning of pure devotion. Mixed devotion, we were talking about yesterday, we gave some examples, we had some case studies of mixed devotion, how people have some material desires, or they're engaged in some ritualistic practice for some material gain, not 100% pure devotion. Pure devotion means we're engaging in activities simply for the satisfaction of Krishna. Now we do see some examples of mixed devotion in Bhagavad Gita. We see how Lord Krishna describes some people come to Krishna consciousness sometimes in search of wealth, sometimes people come in distress, sometimes people come out of curiosity or out of in search of knowledge. Some people may even come looking for liberation. They want to get free from the material world. So these are all examples of mixed devotion, not pure devotion. So on the level of pure devotion, we should understand there are different levels. It's not that everyone who is a pure devotee is the same. Just like Srila Prabhupada is a pure devotee. So it doesn't mean that everyone who is a pure devotee is equal to Srila Prabhupada, and neither does it mean that Srila Prabhupada is equal to pure devotees like Narada Muni, Vyasadeva, although in some sense certainly Srila Prabhupada may be equal to them. But we should understand that even on the level of pure devotion, there are different levels of pure devotion. And we describe these as being sadhana, bhakti, meaning you practice devotion according to the rules and regulations, according to the principles, the scriptures and instructions given by the spiritual teachers. But on a higher level, sadhana bhakti leads to bhava bhakti. Bhava bhakti means one performs devotional service in ecstasy. And we will be hearing about that later on as we go on through this book and through this section. In this first section, this Purva Vibhag, the Eastern section, we will hear about the nature of bhava, the different qualifications for one who is on the level of bhava. For example, they're very careful to utilize every moment of their time in the service of Krishna. And they're strongly attached to being in the holy place. And they're very, very eager to just simply hear about Krishna and associate with devotees. There's a number of characteristics of people who have achieved the level of bhava, and this will be described. But even higher than bhava is prema. Prema means love of God. And love of God is like the full manifestation of bhava. Bhava is like the seed or the beginning of love for Krishna. Just like the light of the sun. When the sun appears in the morning, we see the first rays of the light in the sky. So bhava is like that, the first rays of light. But then, as the sun rises, we see the full manifestation of the sunlight. So that full manifestation, that is prema bhakti, right? Prema bhakti. Prahlad Maharaj is an example of a prema bhakti, prema bhakta. And there are people who are more sadhana bhaktas, like Maharaj Ambarish. People like we want you to understand different levels of devotion. So yesterday we gave the Rupa Goswami's definition of pure devotional service, and he mentioned the two different characteristics, the Swarupa and the Lakshana. Swarupa meaning the essential characteristic which has to be present. And the Lakshana meaning marginal. It may be, it may not be there. So the Swarupa characteristics were there. Anukulina Krishna Nu Shilana, right? Anukula meaning cultivation, activity. And Krishna meaning not only Krishna himself, but Krishna's different incarnations and his devotees and paraphernalia in relation to Krishna. And Shilana, oh, Shilana means activity. Anukulina means favorable, pleasing, should be pleasing to the Lord, and done with the intention to please the Lord also. We give the example demons like Kamsa and Sishupala, that they're also thinking of Krishna, but in an unfavorable manner. So their remembrance of Krishna is not considered pure devotion. Alright, so we mentioned these different characteristics, the Swarupa and the Tatastha, meaning we give up all desire for fruitive activities and philosophical speculation. And then at the end of the class last night, we gave different examples. We discussed some different examples of pure and mixed devotional service. We were analyzing different efforts in rendering service. Some people have different ideas, and some people are motivated in different ways to perform devotional service. And the motivation is not always pure. It's not that everyone is engaging in their activities simply for the pleasure of Krishna. And so then that will be understood to be mixed devotion. Okay, but we're going to be discussing pure devotion mentioned here. Tonight we're going to begin speaking about six characteristics of pure devotional service. There are six characteristics which we should be familiar with in rendering service to Krishna. Here's a quotation from the Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu. Right? The six characteristics are shown here. First of all, Klesh Agni. Klesh Agni. And second, Shubhada. Number three, Moksha Laguta Krit. Four, Sudurlabha. Five, Santrananda Visheshatma. And six, Sri Krishna Karshini. So these are the Sanskrit names for the six characteristics which are there in pure devotion. We will explain further. Klesh Agni, meaning pure devotional service brings immediate relief from all kinds of material distress. I would say people come to Krishna consciousness often in distress. In fact, Srila Prabhupada explained how most of us, particularly in the Western world, that we came to Krishna consciousness in distress. We were very disappointed and frustrated in our life in trying to enjoy the material world. And we were looking for some alternative. Of course, when Srila Prabhupada went to America, at that time there was great turmoil in the society, because America was engaged in a war with Vietnam, and they were recruiting all the young men to go to Vietnam and fight in the war. And of course, many, many young people were not willing to do this. And they were campaigning. They didn't want to go and fight in a war which had no meaning for them. And they knew that many people who went to the war didn't come back. It was a very terrible war. So Srila Prabhupada went to America at that time, and while people were in great turmoil, they were searching, they were inquiring, trying to understand more about life. And they came to Prabhupada with many questions. Now, usually when we had questions, I remember myself growing up in England, growing up as a young person. I have many questions. Whenever I would ask someone, they say, oh, don't worry about them. You'll find out later when you're older. Nobody could give me satisfactory answers. But when we read Srila Prabhupada's books, and when we met the devotees of the Krishna consciousness movement, then we found they had all the answers. They could explain everything. So one particular question is shown here, and this point was made when Sanatana Goswami came to surrender himself to Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Earlier we spoke about Rupa Goswami. So Rupa Goswami's older brother was Sanatana Goswami. And Sanatana Goswami, like his brother Rupa, was also a very prominent man in the government of the Nawab Hussein Shah. So he had been given a Muslim name, Sakaramalik. But after meeting Lord Chaitanya, he had become convinced of the need to surrender himself and join Lord Chaitanya's mission. So he gave up everything. And he came and he met Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu in Benares. Rupa Goswami met Lord Chaitanya at Prayag, at Allahabad. And Lord Chaitanya instructed Rupa Goswami for 10 days. And Sanatana Goswami, he met Lord Chaitanya in Benares, and Lord Chaitanya instructed him for 40 days. So you will see there, in the teachings of Lord Chaitanya, there's one chapter about the teachings to Rupa Goswami, but there are several chapters in relation to Lord Chaitanya teaching Sanatana. So when Sanatana Goswami first came before Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he prostrated himself, offering full obeisances. And then he inquired from Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. He said to Lord Chaitanya that people say that I am a learned scholar. And actually, both Sanatana and Rupa Goswami were both very learned. They could speak many languages. Not only Bengali and Hindi, but they knew Arabic and Persian and Sanskrit. And they could write in them as well. They could write beautiful slokas in the language of Sanskrit. So Sanatana Goswami was confessing to Lord Chaitanya that people say I am a pundit, but actually I do not know who I am. And I do not know why I am suffering. So of course Sanatana Goswami knew these things, but for the sake of hearing transcendental knowledge from the mouth of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, Sanatana Goswami presented himself in this way. He wanted Lord Chaitanya to speak to him the whole philosophy of Krishna consciousness. And it begins like this. First we have to know, who am I and why am I suffering? This is a very good place to begin in trying to understand spiritual knowledge. So it's mentioned here, one of the first characteristics of pure devotion is that it brings immediate relief from all kinds of distress. We see every day how much people are suffering. You know, if you ever go out on book distribution and just stop to talk to people in the streets, it's amazing how much suffering is going on in the world. I remember as a young brahmachari going on book distribution in London and in New York and so many places. Every day, so much suffering, so many people in trouble and so much anxiety. Very troubled world. And of course, Lord Krishna describes it like that in the Bhagavad Gita. Dukalayam ashasvatam. That this world is a temporary place of misery. People are suffering. So how to get free from suffering? We see the first characteristic of pure devotion is we get relief from all kinds of distress. You know, what do people do when they're in distress? Of sometimes people who take some tranquilizer, go to the chemist shop and ask for some kind of tranquilizer, something maybe to put them to sleep, help them to forget. Some people go to the bar, take shelter of alcohol, or some people take some other kind of intoxication or drugs. Those are extreme methods of trying to get relief from suffering. Other people may try other methods to get relief. They may try to do some pious activities, like giving charity. They give charity to the poor. You know, if you go to some ordinary temple and ask the Brahmana there, you know, what can I do to improve my karma? Because we understand suffering is caused by our karma. So what can I do to overcome karma? So the Brahmana may say, oh, you can give charity, donate a cow to the temple, or you can plant a tree, or you can dig a well, do some kind of pious activity like this. So these are some temporary attempts to overcome the suffering of material life. Particularly people who follow Buddhism, they like to do that kind of thing. They like to go and do some charity or perform some kind of pious activity. We talk in China recently, it's become fashionable to put the fish back in the sea. Right? Function. Put the fish back in the sea, or by the birds, let the birds go free. You know, this is the idea that somehow we'll, you know, if the business is not good, sometimes the boss will send the worker, go to the market, put the fish, get some fish, put them back in the sea. Will help us bring some business, get some customers. This is the idea. Of course, this is a very material idea in trying to get relief from the stress. And we'll go ahead here. We want to explain these different terms. We'll look more at them tomorrow. Shubhada means the beginning of all auspiciousness. Right? We like to make things auspicious. So devotional service is the beginning of all auspiciousness. Moksha, labhuta krit, means we derive even the conception of liberation. For someone who is engaged in devotional service, liberation is not a very important. It's not a significant thing. Sudurlabha, pure devotional service, to say, rarely achieved. Not such an easy thing. We know from Bhagavad Gita, only one man among thousands is endeavoring for perfection. And of those who have achieved perfection, hardly one knows the truth. So devotees are rare souls, right? You're all rare souls, fortunate souls. Then, Sandrananda Visheshatma, the devotional service automatically puts one in transcendental pleasure, right? We want to be happy, we want to have to enjoy. So there, this is the highest pleasure, the highest happiness, transcendental pleasure. And finally, Sri Krishna Karshini, it's the only means to attract Krishna. Krishna is all attractive. We're all attracted by Krishna. But Krishna himself is attracted by pure devotion. So we will explain more about these items gradually. First of all, here you can see, we want to show you that there were six items. Now, we explained there are three different levels of pure devotion. We said, first of all, sadhana bhakti. So on the level of sadhana bhakti, then we can experience these two characteristics of pure devotion. Klesha agni, relief from distress, and shubhada, the beginning of all auspiciousness. These are what we would experience in the beginning of our devotion. And if we begin from sadhana bhakti, you know, we don't immediately begin with prema bhakti or bhava bhakti. We have to come to that level. These are very, very high levels of devotion. But sadhana bhakti is also pure devotion. Somebody is doing sadhana, they're also pure devotee. And here you see bhava bhakti. On the level of bhava bhakti, then there are four characteristics. As well as relief from distress and the beginning of all auspiciousness, there's also moksha laguta krit. In other words, it surpasses liberation. And sudurlabha, really achieved. Not such an easy thing. Bhava bhakti, very high thing. And then prema bhakti, on prema bhakti, all six characteristics are manifest in one who is a prema bhakti. So the other two, number five, Sandrananda, Visheshatma, and Sri Krishna Karshi. Right? Sri Krishna Karshi, the only means to attract Krishna. Sandrananda, Visheshatma. We feel that transcendental bliss, the highest. Here you can see, shown together, the three different levels of pure devotion and how they relate to the different characteristics. There's two characteristics on the level of sadhana. There are four characteristics on the level of bhava. And all six characteristics are there at the level of prema bhakti. We want to explain about this. Klesha Agni, suffering. Klesha meaning suffering. There's different kinds of suffering. Adibodhik Klesha, Adiatmik Klesha, Adidaivik Klesha. Right? Miseries inflicted by material nature. Adidaivik. Too hot, too cold, tsunami, earthquake, typhoon, hurricane. This is all Adidaivik. Klesha Adidaivik. Miseries due to the material nature. But then there's adiatmic miseries from the body and mind. And adibodhik miseries inflicted by other living entities. So different types of suffering are there. And we want to get relief from it. Right? We want to destroy it. So klesh agni. Ni, meaning to destroy. We can destroy the suffering by devotional service. Pure devotional service brings immediate relief from all kinds of material distress. Is it a fact? Are you getting immediate relief from all kinds of material distress? Nobody's speaking. Depends upon the intensity, yeah? Okay. Anyway, if you read through Nectar of Devotion, we do find a statement where Srila Prabhupada writes that one should not expect to immediately get relief from these sinful reactions. It will take some time. But at the same time, in the Bhagavad Gita, in the 18th chapter, Lord Krishna says, Sarva dharmam panigeshna mamikam sharanam praja aham tvam sarva papevyo mokshya shyami masuja. I will free you from all sinful reactions. Do not fear. So, how is it affecting a devotee? Why is it? A devotee is suffering sometimes when we circumambulate Tosi Maharani. We offer the prayer, Yani Kani Chapapani Brahmahatya Dekani Cha, right? What is the meaning? That simply by circumambulating this Tosi, we can become freed from the sin of what? Killing a Brahmana. Even the sin of killing a Brahmana. That's a very sinful thing to do. But it's just simply by going around Tosi, we become freed from that sin of killing a Brahmana. So, how does it work? Are we suffering? Are we getting immediate relief from all of our miseries? We have to understand that when we surrender to Krishna, we don't suffer karma anymore. Our karma is finished. Karma is taken away. But still, Prabhupada gives an example. He said, just like the electric fan is running, when you turn off the power, the fan doesn't stop immediately. It's still got some momentum, some energy is there, still rotating. So in the same way, although we have surrendered ourselves to Krishna and we are engaging in devotional service, there's still some residual reactions there. It's not all finished. And there's a nice verse which some of you may know in the 10th canto of Srimad Bhagavatam. Tate nukampam sushamikshamana punjana evatma kritam vibhakam rekvavapuvir vajadam namaste jiveta yomukti pate sadayabhav. This is a prayer offered by Lord Brahma, and he's describing to Lord Krishna that one who tolerates all kinds of adverse conditions but goes on with his devotional service, engaging in associating with devotees, hearing and chanting, then that person becomes qualified to become my unalloyed devotee. So, even though we're doing devotional service, some residual suffering is there. And Krishna arranges these sufferings for our betterment, to help us to come to Him with more feeling, with more, as you said, intensity, right? Because when we come, we still have some conception of the body. We are still identifying ourselves in many material ways. Remember, we spoke about devotional service being sarvupadi vinirmukta. Sarvupadi, upadis mean designations. And we have to give up these designations. There's a parallel verse by Rupa Goswami which describes pure devotional service. And he explains there that just like we have to give up all desires for fruitive activities and philosophical speculation, we have to give up all designations which are born of the material body. So to help us get rid of these designations, Krishna gives us some difficulties. But these difficulties are not karma. A devotee who's taken shelter of Krishna doesn't have karma. Their suffering is not like that. But there's whatever difficulties they undergo, this is the arrangement of Krishna. That Krishna is arranging these difficulties just to help us to come to Him. Just like there's another verse which had a lot of meaning to Srila Prabhupada, which describes that Krishna says, when I am very merciful to someone, then I take all their opulence away from them. And when I take away all of their opulence, in that helpless condition, then they surrender to me. Special mercy. Right? Who wants that? Special mercy. Krishna will take everything away. Harishi Tadanam Shana. And Prabhupada experienced that verse. He had some realization of the meaning of this verse in his own life. That he didn't want to fully surrender himself. He wanted to stay at home and do business. He was thinking, I will make money and I will give it to my spiritual master. But Krishna took everything away. Krishna forced him to leave home and go and live in Vrindavan and dedicate himself to writing books and preaching Krishna consciousness. Prabhupada was very reluctant to do it. Therefore, Krishna had to force him to do it by taking his material attachments away from him. So often we don't realize how attached we are. You know, we think, I'm a devotee. But we have attachments, you know, we have many attachments. And Krishna wants us to get rid of all these attachments. If we want to go back to Godhead, we have to get rid of them. If we still have attachments, we have to take birth again. Okay, so Klesha Agni, pure devotional service, brings relief from all kinds of distress. Three causes of suffering. Why are we suffering? Let's look at the cause of our suffering. Sanatana Goswami asked, why am I suffering? We should be asking this question, we should ask to ourselves. Why is there suffering? I want to be happy, right? She wants to be happy, he wants to be happy. We all want to be happy. Why are we not happy? What is the cause of our suffering? So, in Buddhism also, they talk about this, the cause of suffering. They say, sinful reactions, maybe, causes sinful reactions. First of all, it's reactions to past sins. We've done bad things, so therefore we're suffering. That's one reason. Papa. Another cause, material desires. Now, that's usually where Lord Buddha comes in. He talks about material desires. We have to stop desire. Often, the Buddhists, they think you have to stop desire. No desire. But that is an artificial condition. We cannot be without desire. We have to purify desire. To try to stop desire is artificial. How long can we stop desire? A little while, not very long. Very quickly, more desires will come. So, material desires, sinful reaction, and one more.
Avidya, ignorance.
And it is avidya which is the root cause of all suffering. We want you to understand how the cause, but because of ignorance, we have material desires. And when we have material desires, then we perform sinful activities. And when we perform sinful activities, we get reactions which cause distress. Very simple, right? So three causes of suffering, and the root is ignorance. We want you to understand there are two kinds of sinful reactions. We spoke about sinful reactions. There are two kinds of sinful reactions. They're mentioned here as aparabdha and parabdha. These are the Sanskrit words. Aparabdha, meaning immature or unmanifest. We cannot see it. We haven't seen it. The suffering hasn't come yet, but it's there. It's going to come. It's lying in some subtle form, and the suffering is going to come. But parabdha means mature, manifest. And we see that. We can see the manifestation of our parabdha karma, our suffering, right? Our material body is a manifestation of our parabdha karma. We're all born with a particular body which brings us some happiness and some distress. So parabdha karma, if you have big legal problems, this is our karma. If we have difficulty with our education, we're not able to pass the exams, we're trying and trying, we can never pass the exam. Again, this may be also parabdha karma. This can, because of our karma, we're not able to be greatly successful in our material life. We may be born in a very low family, a very low condition of life. This is also parapta karma. If somebody is born lame or crippled, this is also parapta karma. Sometime back, there was the manager of the English football team, and he made a statement about why someone's a cripple, and why they're lame, and he said this is their karma, and people were furious, and he was forced to resign, to give up his post as the manager of the English football team, because he had made a statement like this. Most people don't like to hear the truth. Try to tell them the cause of suffering. They want to hear some other reason. Okay, so two kinds of sinful reactions. These are both bringing us suffering in the material world. Some we're suffering from already, and the others are going to come in the future and give us suffering. Right? The ones which are not manifest. Prabhupada explains, sinful activities are of two kinds. Those that are mature and those which are not mature. The sinful activities for which we are suffering at the present moment are called mature. The many sinful activities stored within us for which we have not yet suffered are considered immature. We have to understand that this stockpile of sinful reactions is not just only from now, it's not just only from the things we did today, and it's not just only from our birth, but we have been accumulating these things over many lifetimes, and we bring with us from many lives some good and some bad. Some good, we enjoy the results of our good work, and we suffer the results of our bad. So every one of us that are engaged in that, and we've been doing this for a very long time. We have been in this material world a long time. We've been engaging in many different activities. We may try to do good, but even though we're trying to do good, often things go wrong, and you get bad results. Not everybody likes it. It's very hard to please people. You may try to please people, but it's very difficult to please everyone. Here is a verse from the third canto of Srimad Bhagavatam. You can see in the picture Lord Kapila Dev speaking to his mother, Devahuti. And he's given a very interesting instruction about sinful activity. In relation to papam. Papam means sinful activity. Lord Kapila says to his mother, Devahuti says to Kapila Dev, is it? Even a person born in a family of dog eaters immediately becomes eligible to perform Vedic sacrifice if he once utters the holy name of the Supreme Personality of Godhead or chants about. Now, somebody is born in a family of dog eaters. Does that mean they have good karma? Is that a good birth? What do you think? You want to be born in a family of dog eaters? Why are people born in a family of dog eaters? Because of sinful reactions. It means they have some bad karma. Therefore, they've taken birth in a family of dog eaters. Now, who usually performs Vedic sacrifices? Vedic sacrifices should be performed by Brahmanas, yes. But here it is said that even somebody is born in a family of dog eaters, they can perform the Vedic sacrifice. there is qualified as anybody who's a Brahmana. Why it's mentioned here? Because he utters the holy name of the Lord. He hears about his pastimes. He offers obeisances or even remembers them. In other words, this is the power of devotional service, that one may have been greatly sinful in many lives, but simply by engaging in the devotional service of the Lord, then we become relieved of all of these sins. We can become relieved of all of the sins. We can, and as stated here, we can even perform the Vedic sacrifice. We can become Brahmanas and perform the Vedic Yajna. So this is certainly surprising. Of course, some people are very much against this. But when Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati and Srila Prabhupada were preaching and giving Brahman initiation to people, then it's very controversial. Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati gave to Indians who were not born in, well, even of course, Narottam Das Thakur was initiating people. He was a guru, but he was not a Brahman. So they were very angry at him. You should be a Brahman to be a guru. But Narottam Das Thakur was a great devotee of the Lord. He had been trained by Jiva Goswami. He was very qualified. And so his disciples established on the basis of scripture the position of the devotee. According to scriptures, anybody who is properly trained and initiated, then they can be a Brahmana. So this is a fact. Of course, who wants to be trained? We see not everybody comes for the training. People are too busy. Oh, I have to work. No, I don't have time for training. Oh. And then when they get old, oh, now I'm old. No, I can't come now. Yeah. Very unfortunate, but actually training should be there in the beginning. In the beginning of life, Komara Charet Prabhno, from the age of 5, we should put the children in the Gurukula, we should have them trained up in Krishna consciousness in very early stages, so that they can become nice Brahmanas. Okay, so? From the Nectar of Devotion, first chapter, it is stated, one who is engaged in Krishna consciousness and devotional service has without doubt become free from all contaminations of material sinful activity. Devotional service, therefore, has the power to actually nullify all kinds of reactions to sinful deeds. Of course, we have to remember that we can nullify sinful deeds, but it doesn't mean that the next day we should continue to go on and do sinful deeds. That is offensive. In the chanting of the holy name, the seventh offense is to commit sin on the strength of chanting. That somebody may think that, oh, I'm doing some sinful activity today, I'll chant more tomorrow to make up or to destroy the sins. So this kind of devotion, this kind of chanting is offensive. It is not pleasing to Krishna. So we want to get the full benefit from devotional service. We have to give up all kinds of sinful activity. We may have been sinful. There are many examples. Ajamil, of course, is a very good example. Srila Prabhupada gave the name Ajamila to one devotee in Australia. There was one man, a young man, Arthur Smith, his name was. And then Prabhupada said, your name is Ajamila Das. Ajamila was a very sinful person. And everybody was Prabhupada is giving him the name of a very sinful person. So then Prabhupada, of course, went on to explain more about Ajamila, that Ajamila was a Brahmana as a young man, but he became degraded by bad association But somehow, at the end of his life, he was able to be saved by calling the name of his son, which happened to be Narayan, the name of the Lord. So, Prabhupada was explaining how a sinful person, he was very sinful, but he was saved because he chanted the name of the Lord. He was saved from going to hell. So many devotees were all sinful people, but we come to Krishna consciousness and we can give up all the bad habits. As Prabhupada says here, all of our sinful reactions are destroyed. Of course, we said it takes a little time, not immediately, but gradually. If we continue with devotional service, then gradually we get the sinful activity. Here's a from the Padma Purana. There's a statement here. It is stated in the Padma Purana that there are four kinds of effects due to sinful activities. All these four effects become immediately vanquished for those who surrender unto the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Vishnu, and become engaged in this devotional service in full Krishna consciousness. So we're going to look at these four kinds of effects. We were talking about Parabdha and Aparabdha. In other words, that some effects are manifest and some are not manifest. But there's some other statements also which we should know about, which are described in the scriptures. It's important to understand this, because it's only through this understanding that we can have the full appreciation of Bhakti Yoga. That it is only by Bhakti Yoga that all the four kinds of effects can be removed. Prabhupada gives the example, elephant taking a bath gets nice and clean in the water, but after coming out of the water, then he throws dirt on himself. In the same way, people may go to Rameshwara. Right? There's how many wells are there in Rameshwara? Huh?
12.
No, more than that. There are many wells there, and all the waters from all the different holy places is there, many wells, and of course people come. I remember all the Malaysian, many Malaysian devotees were there last year, and they went to Tirupati, to Rameshwaram, and you know, I would take bath at every well, right? They're very enthusiastic, the man takes a bucket of water from the well and throws it over everyone. And of course, that water coming from the well is very cool, very cold, you know. And so after you've been through, you know, many wells, you're feeling quite cold. The idea is that by taking bath in the holy place, people think, I will be relieved of my bad karma. I'll get rid of my sinful reactions. But the desire for sin is still there. That even though they've performed some punya, they've done some pious activity by taking bath there, it hasn't taken away the desire to do sin. That's the problem. Prabhupada gives another example. He said, just like a person may be afflicted with sexually transmitted disease, venereal disease, and in order to cure that disease, he may have to undergo painful treatment. And after being cured, he still has the desire for his sinful activity. The desire for sin has not stopped. Even though he suffered, even though he had so many embarrassing and uncomfortable situations, but still the desire for sin is still there. So this is the problem with simply performing some pious activity. Like I said, giving charity to the poor, distributing the medicine for the people, helping young girls who are not married to find a husband, these kind of things, you know, this is all punya karma. This is all very pious things, pious activities. But these pious activities don't take away our desire for sin. But bhakti yoga does take away the desire for sin. By performing devotional service, pure devotional service, then we have no more desire for sinful things. Prabhupada saw the example, young people coming to Krishna consciousness, how they were engaged in many sinful activities, but once they started chanting Hare Krishna, then they stopped all of the nonsense. They gave up all of their sinful activities.
So we're going to look at these different stages of sin. Okay, first of all, we have papa, meaning sinful activity, right? Sinful activity results in aparabdha karma. The reaction may not be manifest immediately. We've done something wrong. Oh, you think, oh, maybe Krishna didn't notice, right? Maybe he didn't notice when I said, I got away with it, right? Nobody knows. Maybe even Krishna didn't notice. Because we didn't suffer, we didn't get any reaction. But the reaction may be lying in a dormant state. It hasn't come yet. Krishna's waiting for the time.
So that's the unmanifest.
And then you see the unmanifest karma eventually will become manifest. Sometimes we get karma immediately. I remember there was one song, John Lennon here, Instant Karma. Right? He certainly got a lot of instant karma. Right? So parabdha, the aparabdha becomes parabdha, it becomes manifest. We get the reactions for the sins.
And then there's another stage, however, which we want you to know about,
which is called kutam. Kutam means the disposition towards sin, or a propensity towards sin. That, you know, some people have, they just have that kind of nature, they're just inclined towards sinful activity. The desire is not there, it's in a more subtle stage. It's, we say, proclivity, means they can do it. They can do sinful activity. Although they haven't got the desire immediately. So kutam is the initial stage. And that kutam goes to another stage, which is called bija, or sinful desire. Bija means seed. Right? Kutam means the preliminary stage before the seed. Even before the seed is there, that's kutam. There's an attraction towards sinful activity. Somebody, you know, that sinful propensity is like kutam. Some interest, people are, oh, you know, they become interested, they become inclined towards sinful activity. And then it becomes more a seed, a desire to do sin. Just like we think desire comes in stages, the mind, thinking, feeling and willing. When we come to the willing stage, then you have to do it. In the beginning, we're just thinking, we're just contemplating about it. Thinking, then feeling, we become more attached to it, and then willing, have to do it. So, here we have kutam, bijam, and parabdha.
All coming from aparabdha.
So when we have sinful desire, then the sinful desire will go to sinful activity. It begins with the unmanifest reaction. Why do we have the desire? We have the desire for sin because of some aparabdha karma. Some people are just inclined towards sinful activity. So kutam, abhijam, and then comes to papa. The sinful desire results in sinful activity, and then you get more reactions. The reactions come in two phases, sometimes unmanifest, sometimes manifest. Will be manifest eventually. So like this, you can see the cycle between the different stages of sinful reaction. So four stages of sin. Papam, kutam, bijam, paramtam. Now, if we perform a normal pious activity, just like you give some charity, or you plant a tree, or you fast on just any day. So you do fasting for some. So you're doing some kind of austerity, so you get some benefit for that. But that kind of benefit will only act on the on certain stages. It will help us to take away the aparabdha reactions. It may help a little bit with the kutam, but the parabdha karma, which is still there, that's not going to be affected. You do some charity, that parabdha karma will have that until practically probably to the end of the body. So the doing pious activity only helps to take away some phase of the sinful reactions. Prabhupada explains, the vices in their different stages of development are analyzed here. Phalan mukham, vice. Phalan mukham meaning manifest, the fruits of our work. Phalan mukham vice is that which we may be undergoing at the present stage of life. Bijam vice is in the seedling process by our desires of different types. Kutam is prior to the stage of bijam, that is in the germinating stage. So from aparabdha you get kutam, and kutam leads to bijam, and bijam leads to papa. In other words, the unmanifest reactions are shown first of all in the stage of kutam, which is prior to the germinating stage, prior to the seed becoming the sin becoming a seed, and then it goes on to become a seed, and then the seed grows, and then it becomes an activity, and in this way we engage in sinful activity. In this way we suffer. Aparabdha, meaning unmanifest, is the fountain source of all. And from the storehouse of vicious life, all other stages develop. And all these stages of vicious life become at once switched off by adoption of devotional self. So we're explaining that it's only by devotional service that we can actually get rid of all the sins, the effect of all of our sinful activities. Other activities, just simply putting the fish back in the sea and letting the birds go free, or maybe sometimes people become a monk and they go and live in the temple or become a monk for some time, you know, give some temporary relief. But it doesn't take away the desire for sin. This is the point. Only pure, unalloyed devotional service can take away all desires for sinful activity. It's only possible by bhakti yoga. This is the supreme power of bhakti yoga, that it takes away even the desire for sin. Other activities will not. Avidya, ignorance. There are many, many snakes on the ground of the forest. And when a fire takes place, it burns the dry foliage and the snakes are immediately attacked. Similarly, the blazing fire of Krishna consciousness is so strong that the snakes of ignorance are immediately killed. Remember, we described avidya, or ignorance, as being the root of all sin, the root of all distress, the root cause of all suffering in the material world. From ignorance came material desire. And from material desire came sinful activities. And with sinful activities, sinful reactions follow. But Krishna consciousness is described here just like a fire, a blazing fire. And when there's a fire in the forest, then the snakes have no hope of survival. They're all going to be burned. Other animals, they have four legs, they have a chance to run, to escape. But the snakes have no chance. So these snakes are compared to ignorance. So that the snakes of ignorance can be burned up by the fire of bhakti yoga, by Krishna consciousness. Same thing I was just mentioning, the three causes of suffering. Papa, sinful reactions. Bija, material desires, the seed of material desires. And avidya, ignorance. When we understand the nature of suffering, then we can be more conscious about acting in the proper manner. The devotee is known by their behavior, right? Srila Prabhupada was asked how to recognize a devotee. Oh, he said they will be perfect gentlemen. They will not do any nonsense. They will not do any sinful activities. Oh. We're not going to do that. We talked about these six characteristics of pure devotional service. We spoke about the different stages which they manifest, right? There are three stages of pure devotion. Sadhana, bhava, and prema. And at the stage of sadhana, then there is immediate relief from all kinds of material distress. And it's the beginning of all auspiciousness. And then, on the stage of bhava, there are two more further qualities that one derives even the concept of liberation. One who is on the level of bhava is not very much interested at all in liberation because the happiness of devotional service is so much greater. But it was also mentioned that that level of bhava is readily achieved. And finally, prema bhakti was the only means to attract Krishna and also puts one on the highest pleasure of transcendental happiness. So these were the different stages. Then we talked about klesh agni, bringing relief from material distress. People are in distress, certainly. Everywhere we go, people need Krishna consciousness. And we can see that when people come to Krishna consciousness, that how they change, that in the beginning, when they first come, they're suffering so much, and so much anxiety, they're so depressed, they have so many problems, but simply by chanting and engaging properly in devotional activities, they become joyful souls. They actually become happy. And Srila Prabhupada expected the devotees to be happy. Prabhupada had one servant, actually. His servant, his name was Purushottam. And Prabhupada noticed that he was looking very unhappy. And Prabhupada told him, he said, if you are morose, you cannot be in Krishna consciousness. So a devotee is a joyful soul. Brahma Buddha Prasannatma. One who knows that we're Brahman, we're not the body, then naturally he will become happy in his consciousness, in his purpose of life.
So Klesh Agni, devotional service brings immediate relief.
Then we explained about the four kinds of effects of sin and how devotional service has the power to nullify all kinds of sinful reactions. And there, if you read the text, we will see also different analogies and Sanskrit verses are there describing this. So four kinds of effects of sin: Parabdha, Aparabdha, Kuta, and Bija. Should be first actually Aparabdha, the unmanifest stage, and then the Kuta, the beginning of the desire, the propensity, or the disposition towards sinful activity, and then Bija, the seed, the germinating seed, will become interested, more interest, stronger interest to perform sinful activity. And then from Bija, then Parabdha karma, then Aparabdha karma, maybe, or Papam. First of all, after Bija, then it will be Papam, sinful activity. We'll perform some sinful activity, and that will bring more karma. So like this, there's a cycle, there's a connection. But only Krishna consciousness has the power to nullify all of these different stages with the effect that they will not come up again. Srila Prabhupada writes, material contamination is very subtle. Its beginning, its fruition and results, and how one suffers such results in the form of distress are part of a great chain. When one catches some disease, it is often very difficult to ascertain the cause of the disease. The practical injection to stop all the fructifications of the seeds of our sinful activities is simply engagement in Krishna consciousness. Just like you have some seeds, so if you fry the seeds, then you can't grow, they're not going to sprout. You can't expect to sprout a seed which has already been fried. So we have to fry our material desires. And the method of frying these material desires is by engaging in bhakti yoga, engaging in devotional service. So Srila Rupa Goswami, along with the other Goswamis, they compiled these books like Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu, Nectar of Devotion, with so many evidences from the scriptures to convince us of the importance of bhakti yoga. That it's not a waste of time. It's very powerful. Right? Concluding quote, this sinful desire seed can be removed only by achieving Krishna consciousness. And this can be accomplished very easily by chanting the Maha Mantra or Hare Krishna Mantra, as recommended by Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. In other words, unless one adopts a path of devotional service, he cannot be 100% clean from all the reactions of sinful activities. Okay. So that's the end. We will ask if there's any question.
Do get manifest, all these two reactions.
Yes. They will, eventually. We don't know when. We give the example, just like if you do some gardening. So you may put seeds in the ground. So not all the seeds will come up at the same time. But the other seeds, which didn't come up, they're still there in the soil. And they may wait till the next season, till the next harvest, before they come up, before they begin to sprout. So similarly, simple reactions is like that. That we have some simple reactions from this life, and we have also from previous lives also. Not only do we have simple reactions from our own life, we take simple reactions from other people also. Family members. You're taking money, you're accepting wealth maybe from them, or you work for a company. So you get your involved with karma. Sanatana and Rupa Goswami, they were working for Mohammedans, and these Mohammedans were killing cows. So they knew it was very sinful. So they wanted to get away from it. You know, they had big positions in the government. We may think, why didn't they just stay in the government and help them? But they were working for sinful people. So when you work for sinful people, then you have to take some karma from them. You're taking money from them. Now these reactions may not manifest in this life, but they're there. You don't know when they will come. It's a question of time. We said Krishna knows when is the right time. But if we engage fully in devotional service, then you can wipe them off. All of these past sins. I said, just like a blazing fire, but burns unlimited amounts of fuel to ashes. So, you know, we may have a stockpile of sinful activities, but one spark of pure devotion that can burn up all the fuel, all of that fuel of sinful reactions. It can all be removed just by sincere, genuine, loving devotion for the pleasure of Krishna. Chanting his holy name, engaging in his service.
Now, when we do this in our day-to-day practice of Krishna consciousness, along with this, we also associate with other people, and we go to work, we get into other, I mean, which we are, for whatever reason, there's a certain force which forces us to do all that. Now, would that be a transgression? Like, on one hand, we are practicing Krishna consciousness, on the other hand, we are also involving and associated with the other elements. So, what happens to that karma?
Well, you have to be very careful. You have to protect yourself from contamination. You're working with people, associating with people who are not devotees. Just like a doctor goes into places where people are sick, and he has to treat them. He has to make sure he doesn't get contaminated. He doesn't want to get sick. So in the same way, we have to protect ourselves very carefully. If you know we're associating in a non-devotional atmosphere, you have to protect yourself by good chanting and hearing, by doing devotional service. The morning program. A morning program is very important. Chant sometime in the day. Maybe you, in the morning you're very busy, you have to get the family off to work. Yeah, after they go to work, then you have to do it. Then you have to do your chanting. Let them all go off to work and go to school and everything. Then you're free. Then you can chant. Do your service for Krishna. If you're fighting a fire, you have to make sure you don't get burned. The firemen going into the building when there's a fire, they protect themselves. So in the same way, we have to protect ourselves by our own spiritual practice. So Lord Chaitanya told the devotees, be careful. He told them, he said, don't eat food from non-devotee people, people don't take money even from people who are not devotees. Lord Chaitanya was pointing out to one of his followers that if you take money or eat food from materialistic people, your mind will become contaminated. So we want to protect. And they said, when the mind is polluted, then it's very difficult to remember Krishna. Some places, you know, people have a habit, they go out and they eat out every day. We know in Singapore, everybody eats out. People, I was shocked, they told me 98-99% of Singapore all eat out on a Sunday or something, and everybody's out eating. But of course we are, we come to the temple and come to the temple and eat prasada, that's all. Don't want to be going to restaurants, materialistic, non-devoted people cooking, not healthy for us.
Getting up early in the morning becomes not very difficult.
What is
it? To perform good sadhana, to do good sadhana, I feel that getting up early in the morning is very important, because daytime, once the day starts, afternoon, and then even if you try to do sadhana, it's very difficult to keep the mind. But getting early in the morning itself is a, because that time is kind of not in, at least for my case it happens that it's not in my control, because either closed and I don't know.
Because you don't have the habit. Because you were never trained to chant in the morning. Now you have to begin.
Actually, before I came to Singapore, I used to get up early. After coming to Singapore also, for a month or so I continued, I used to get up early before Mangalarati and used to complete some round, but now somehow it doesn't work.
Well, you've lost the desire. You've become an influence by bad association. How could you give up the bad habit? How could you give up the good habits? You had the habit in the beginning, and you come here and gradually you give it up. So you have to again find that determination, that enthusiasm to do this. It's important. If you know something is important, you do it. Maybe in the beginning, a little difficulty, but you have to keep trying. Man proposes, God disposes. If you have that desire, Krishna will help you. You can do it. There are many other devotees. They wake up happy. It's important for us, for our spiritual life. It's the best time of the day for chanting. Brahma Muhurta. So here in Singapore, Brahma Muhurta is a bit later than most places. You're lucky. You're lucky here in Singapore, because it doesn't become daylight until about 7 o'clock. So Brahma Muhurta, we have Mangalarti, like in Kuala Lumpur, they do Mangalarti 5:15. What time is it here also? 5:15.
Same.
Yeah, so like that. In other places, it's 4:30. But here, it's later, you know. And still you can't get up. Let's go. You can do it. I told you before, you have to get association. You have to do something. You have to put your alarm clock out of reach. So that when your alarm clock goes off, you have to get up and turn it off. You have to have a little more determination if you want to do it. The problem is, if you don't do the chanting in the morning, it's very difficult to do it later in the day. so many things are in the mind and so on. Much better to do this first things first. Get your chanting, do a good number of rounds before you go out. That makes your day much more easier. There's no other way, sorry. But this is what you have to do. You want to become Krishna conscious, you want to conquer over the mind. We have to get up in the morning. We have to get a good start to the day. And you'll see the difference once you start doing it. It makes a big difference. Prabhupada said, like, you go to Mangalarti, your whole day is auspicious. In every spiritual culture, they have that habit of waking up early in the morning. The Buddhists, they have them, you know, their meditation, they're always awake. It's 4 o'clock, usually. I don't know about here in Singapore, maybe it's a bit later. But usually it's like 4 o'clock, they wake up. And the Muslims, Islam, they have their morning prayers. Usually same time as a Mangalarti, you can hear them doing morning prayers. If there's some mosque nearby, you'll hear them reciting the Quran morning prayers. Probably about 5 o'clock in India, it will be 4:30. Same time as our Mangalarti. So, Christian also, they have also Catholic Church, they have morning mass. We're no different from anybody else. Everyone knows the importance of that time of the day. Very powerful. Well, you have to try to get some more association. You have to have somebody help you make a regular practice, a regular habit to be up in the morning. And then at night, you know, you won't have any, you'll be so tired when it comes to bed. You won't have time for any sinful activity. And you can take rest early. Bro, you had a question?
We are doing services in temples and at home also. How we can make the service pure? Like, I mean, what should be my mood when I am doing that service? How, what should I pray to the Lord when I am doing the service?
Well, we simply want to do that service for the pleasure of Krishna. We simply want to please Him. Just like you're offering a flower, and then we pray to Krishna that, dear Lord Krishna, please kindly accept this flower. Dear Lord Krishna, we have prepared this food for you. Please kindly accept it. Even though we're unqualified, even though we have no qualification, and you're the Supreme Lord, and you have many goddesses of fortune all serving you, but still, we're trying to serve them. We want to offer something to you. So we pray that somehow we can please you.
So like that, we pray in a humble way. We have to consider whatever service we offer to Krishna is insignificant.
But we pray that somehow Krishna will accept it. Krishna is attracted by devotion. So when we have proper devotion, it's not the offering so much which Krishna wants, but it's the devotion. So we want to have that although I have no devotion, we may say to Krishna, although I have no devotion, still I'm trying to develop some devotion. So in this way we want to feelingly, from the heart, we want to feelingly offer our prayers to